Hello everyone, I made a mistake. That timer was not a lie. We're already live, so.
Oh, was the timer a lie? I don't know why you don't just have like a different image. Like, why do you use the break screen for like the load screen?
What else am I supposed to use?
I don't know. You could even like literally anything. That stupid dumbass picture of me that you refuse to get rid of. Like literally anything.
Oh, I could. Well, I just figured because I know you use it without the timer, it's almost consistent. So I
Out.
figure whatever.
We got a 5-month resub coming from X. Oh my god, I'm on fire! He says, I love you guys so much. Keep doing what you love. That's an incredibly calm comment from somebody who's on fire, but thank you so much.
It's not even on caps. Okay.
Currently, we are in the lobby. Keem just taking a few moments to join us, but looks like we're about good to go. It's Sam and Snooter here. I called this match a spicy match on Twitter.
Did you? Really?
Yes, because I think it's going to be a spicy matchup.
Spicy.
Very nice. Actually, I gotta go check in on that Twitter, on that Twitch poll and see who's voting for which mermaid. I'm gonna be really upset if only like two people voted, which I imagine is probably what's happened, because nobody uses the damn thing.
Well, since I still use TweetDeck, it doesn't show polls. Like it barely even
Well,
alerts me that there is a poll.
it's not like a poll. It's just go to the channel. It says like use this emote for blank, use this emote for blank. We got two people and two people,
Oh,
so
you linked
it's
to the
literally
Twitch
tied up.
thing. Oh, okay.
We're literally tied up. Some people want top half fish, some people want top half human. I mean, it's anonymous, so we're not judging you, but I'm just gonna be honest, who the fuck wants a top half fish?
People who want to have sex.
Just saying, there's things like fleshlights and dildos, and like we live in an adult world where there are things to help make up for that.
I mean, you can also just like put a plastic. No, not a plastic bag. Don't do that.
Whoa,
Paper
paper bag it.
bag.
Paper bag it. All right.
Oh God, don't do it. Anyway, Ruins of Endion in the bottom left as the blue
Oh.
Zerg. It is Liquid Snoot.
Well, this is not. This is interesting. Bottom right, we got the red Terran player Keen. But an interesting update from Maturino. So I'm going to read this out, and hopefully I'm not going to misappropriate the number here. But Maturino says they want to spice things up with the stretch goals. Maturino is going to pledge $20 for every $100 that we raise. So for example, like we have to hit the $200 goal that we set for today, like we normally do. Okay, cool. Do that. Then every $100 afterwards, they're going to put in another 20. So that's pretty neat. That's not saying that, like, oh my god, guys, reach into your wallets and start throwing money at the stream, at the players, at the prize pool, but that's a cool incentive to have.
Cool.
It's a cool bonus, I think, is probably the better way to phrase it.
Oh yeah, they just added all of them like while I was looking at the webpage. Interesting. Yeah, I mean I saw that when I was looking at the other Maturino things and I thought that maybe it was just like something they had worked out, but I guess it's all over. That's cool. Well, anywho, Keen versus Snoot, TVZ, Ruins of Endion being the default first map, and then losers pick after that. It's always the way we do things. Or like 99% of the way we do things anyway on these weekly cups. I can actually think of another different way we do it. The weekly cup?
Sometimes you veto. I don't know.
We haven't done
But
vetoes for
Keen.
weekly cups in a while.
Well, Keen is quite interesting because if you guys recall, he was actually playing. I think it was. Was it Major? He played somebody recently in like the finals of one of our things.
Yeah, so it was Keen versus Major.
Yeah.
Semifinals yesterday.
Yeah, that was actually like. I expected Keen to win or at least go 3-2, but he got like 3-0'd by Major. So the only reason I bring this up is like it's Snoot now, it's a different matchup, all this stuff, but it's surprising to me.
He got.
Like it's truly surprising to me.
Yeah, he got 2-0'd. Pretty badly. Like, Macrigan didn't look very good, and then he got cheese the next game, didn't look very good. But yeah, it was a different matchup. I don't know what it was about Keen with that matchup, though, that was so off-putting for him. But he tried to fix it. I guess didn't couldn't not against cheese, and hopefully he's feeling better in this matchup. I still would give it to Snoot just because I think Snoot's been really solid lately, and Keen has been he's solid usually, but sometimes he has his off days.
So Snoot has said it himself, so I'm just gonna kind of restate it here, but if Snoot gets to the late game, he feels like he's unbeatable. Like, if he gets to that arc, it's not even about just having Ultra List, because the fact that he knows how to use every aspect and utilize every angle of Zerg, without maybe Swarmhouse being included in that statement, but for the most part, like, I would agree. I actually think Snoot, against most Terrans, if he can get to that point, is going to be unbeatable. The problem is getting to that point, though. As we've seen with Euthermal, Keen, Mage, just about every Terran we've ever cast, the idea, though, is to try and kill that Zerg before they get to that point. You don't want the game to go late. You don't want them to get to Ultra List. You don't want to have to tangle with any of that nonsense.
Yeah, that's certainly true. Snoot's getting pretty close to the levels of, like, Nurchio defense, though. Although Nurchio's defense lately hasn't been as good as it was. But let's think back to the, you know, best of 15 against Euthermal. Nurchio's defense looked unbeatable. Snoot was getting pretty close to that, honestly, and that's why he's able to get to the late game so often.
Yeah. Fothu. Nope. Oh, sorry, this stream delay contributes. Top half Rifkin. Or sorry, bottom half Rifkin, top half Zombie Grub.
Sorry,
that's some, There's a word for that. I'm trying to remember what it is.
Is there?
Yeah, Futa or something. I'm sadly not well versed enough in this universe to know.
What?
But anyways, I that was not an option, and I would also like to say that we would make a better Archon than a mermaid.
Yeah, I agree with that one. Thanks, follow Nixtella for the 2-month resub. Smiley face. Woo.
But by the way, because she was asking, I know a couple others were too. We talked about it yesterday real quick before this game heats up too much. The Twitch Clips winners still have not been picked yet, and a lot of this has to do with just working with Ting and them being a little bit busy on their end. But we'll get that sorted ASAP. Don't you guys worry.
Yeah. Sort things out. Well, this drop is actually fairly standard. It's not too standard to go over here, but as you can see, the rocks are broken down over here, so...
I'm not sure if the tank on the low ground was intentional or not, but I actually like it on the low ground a lot.
Yeah. It's not as nice as that other position, which Snoot, you know, he already thought of. He took down the rocks. He wasn't going to let that happen. So unfortunately, Keen, this isn't an all-in, but it is something that, you know, can sometimes last for a very long time. Won't be able to get the damage that they really wanted. I was going to say, with these rocks being broken down, he has a little bit of, possibility here, which is kind of funny. It's like Snoot did one thing great and then kind of messed up on this part, but...
I like the Liberator coming in too, but as we see, you're kind of limited. Once those links get on top of the tank, that's where this gets a little bit hard to hold, but those Marines on the high ground take on those links no problem.
I mean,
you're kind of just blanketed by a Liberator. Not advancing the Liberator forward, but using it to cover the Marines in the tank, I actually like quite a bit. 5 Queens and a couple Spore Crawlers coming to the fight, though, and he's just going to throw that right in the backside, or at least try to.
It's really awkward. It's actually distracting the Marines. Another Spore Crawler comes in here. It gets, like, one shot off on the Liberator. Finally, more Lings are on the way.
It's interesting, though, because Snoot has insisted to play on this Ling-heavy style, using things like Spore Crawlers advancing the front lines, rather than go Roaches and Ravagers. And I do want to note, he's gone for ranged weapon upgrades with this. Like, I'm really curious why Ravagers weren't an option for him here. Why they weren't part of his build or the opening leading into this.
Yeah, I didn't even notice that he had gotten the Roach Warren, so I was really wondering, like, okay, what's this plus 2 missile attack for? So, yeah, I don't know. Maybe he just really thought he's going to be able to take care of it with his amount of queens, which, could have been an option again, maybe, if he hadn't broken on these rocks. He could have gotten, like, a surround of the queens, I don't know, but Snoot has some pretty good queen defense, and he's been able to hold pushes like that, like, exactly like that, with just queens and a handful of lings, so he probably thought, like, oh, I don't really want to waste the money on roaches if I can hold it here. And I'll just go back into droning. But when that didn't work, he was kind of in an awkward position of, like, do I make roaches now or do I just make more lings now? But either way, he kept on making more queens for sure. Like, Snoot really likes his queens in most matchups. But this is actually an extraordinary amount. I mean, we've seen him go up to 7 or 8 before. That's kind of crazy when he's like only being on 3 bases. He's going up to 11. That's quite a lot of queens.
I mean, Snoot plays Queen Heavy, but 11 is kind of crazy. That's like, you start questioning Nidus Worms at that point.
Yeah, it's really like you start questioning Yeah, like, what can he use the queens for? So Nidus Worm all-ins, you know, there's those old Roach Ravager queen all-ins that, you know, on, like, Frozen Temple or, Lurelak Crest, and then maybe Fast Ultras, you're getting prepped for all the chance fuses, but he's not going necessarily that quickly in Ultras. In fact, he's taking a pit stop almost at Patching Lands and, you know, actually upgrading his Infestors, and, but still, like, having 11 queens, that means... Let's see.
Double drops in the main. Well, this goes on up here. But the Spore Crawlers from earlier catch the meta with the majority of units inside of it. So, not a problem. Drones get pulled. Woodmines can be a little bit nasty, but the Queen and these drones, small reinforcements, should be able to clean it up. Soon, on the other hand, is still fighting this front line. That tank is quite dangerous. Lenient Unseashed has got a bit more mobility. Dancing in on the front lines with Keen. Stims in, stims out. Looks like that drop in the main, not fully cleaned up, by the way. It's only like one Marine left. It won't die. He's killed like 50. He's got 7 kills on him.
That's pretty impressive. It just wouldn't die with the medevac healing him. The main push is sent away by Snoots. And I was going to say, like, he has 4 queens injecting at all times. So he'd have still at least, at the time, like 7 queens. Now it's up to 13 queens. So he's up to 9 queens on the front line. I guess maybe 1 or 2 trying to spread creep as well, but like a lot of them are getting a lot of transfuse energy. Another double drop into the main, this time with Marauders, so I mean they'll be able to take down the Infestors really quickly. They'll get surrounded easier by the Lings, but they can actually take out structures now pretty quickly, and this is eventually more than just drone killing, although that's pretty damn good too. Zach at the top is waiting.
Snitch put his forces here really nicely, though. Oh, those fungal growths are going to be sick, nasty. Takes out most of the medevacs. Drop in the main, finally getting cleaned up. Took some time. Lost a lot of drones over it, but still sitting on 57, spread on 4 bases. Not too shabby. Keen's not too far behind, though. He's on 4 bases himself. And we got double shoutouts we got to give out to Anders MR for the 7-month resub and Fothu for the 6-month resub as well. Thank you both for supporting the channel. Continue to be awesome.
Well, we still have 3 Infestors, 12 Queens, and mostly Ravagers, actually. Not even a lot of Roaches here. It's a pretty powerful army, but it is, in a way, delicate. As again, without that Roach buffer, like, you know, those go down, everything else goes down pretty quickly. Unless the Transfuses are on point, which I assume they will be for Snoot. But that Hive is about halfway done. We don't have any upgrades into Melee, but that doesn't mean you can't go into Ultralisk. I mean, I think it's more common is what we are seeing nowadays, is, like, the fast Melee. But it's still, like, the Carapace is the most important thing, getting that plating afterwards, of course, too, and providing that buffer for the rest of your army. And they're still going to chunk away at units if you get the Infestors Fungal down, and that's usually the most important part. The Spire starts, but a little bit after the Hive, so, like, not the best paired up thing here, if he is going to go for a Greater Spire immediately. But I've seen worse.
Carapace is definitely always going to take precedence. Ultras come built in with, like, huge damage. They really don't need upgrades so much as these other units do, but Keen has been, as a point, a little bit slow with his own upgrades. Like, he's only just finishing up 2-2.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point. He got to a 4th base pretty quickly. But apparently, we did a long time to get a planetary. Like, that base has been there for a while. I know we haven't highlighted it, but I definitely saw it on the minimap. Oh well, anyway. It was under attack, so I guess it doesn't matter. Queens on the front lines, they're gonna miss a couple of transfuses. The fungals go down. That's the only fungals I think that are available, though. He doesn't really have, like, a mass amount of infestors. And he is not quite prepared for a main engagement. 16 more roaches are on the way, using up the rest of his supply.
Drop the top, this goes on. That 4th base under attack. Does manage to drive that off. Lots of just multitasking going on from Keen throughout this entire game. I love it.
Yeah, it's really good. He actually goes into the top base. It loses the medevac, apparently, so this is going to be not too much more damage. Probably get the queen at the end there, but this attack is far more important. Snoot is trying to go for a greater spire, and that's Brute still Lord, so far off.
Well, the roaches and ravagers, they're not taking too bad of a fight leading into the fungal growth. Doesn't really help as much as you think it would, but Keen's army is not being resupplied immediately. He does have reinforcements on the way, but they're quite a distance out.
There is, like, what, 12 medevacs, and all of them are over here, and none of them off to the right side. So the Roaches and Ravagers took care of a good chunk of Keen's army.
Queen just marching forward. Gonna drop a ton of creep on that front line, by the way.
Yeah, they still have a lot of energy. I mean, the Queen kind of certainly been culled down to 6, so not a lot of transfuses for that Tier 3 army, which originally thought was going to be Ultralisk, but as apparent now it's going to be a Greater Spire. Snoot does have to be careful not to lose too much more in the attack, though. I mean, I understand seeing an opportunity to win the game, but if you don't win the game, then you just use all of your bank on not the Greater Spire, which is kind of his plan here.
Yeah, and let's not forget too, he just invested in like four more infestors because he bled out the ones he had on the front line. So unfortunately, that's a lot of gas sent in a direction he may not have wanted it to go. It is cool to see this go in the direction of Broodlords, though, and I kind of like this. You got to consider there's not really any Liberators. There's no Viking control. And I guess Ultras could eventually be guided down by this many Marauders, this many Marines that have been continually being invested into. Just lots of little cool things going on here as we get towards the possible end of the game. That's impossible with an asterisk.
Quickly checked Keen's vision. He has no idea about the Hive, but, like, Hive around this time, you're going to guess they have a Hive. What's more important is he has no idea about a Spire. If you see a Spire morphing this late into the game, you're going to be like, okay, you're probably going to go for a greater Spire. Like, super late mutas.
Was that one Spore Claw you need for the top, right?
Right? Those spider effects are so low. One Queen, actually, if you focus fired.
Nice!
But he's probably really assuming that the Ultras are on their way, and it's just like, where's the Ultras? He's really not thinking about a potential greater Spire. Now that he sees Corruptors, he's like, oh shit, that's an option, and might want to start thinking about Liberators and Vikings, and yeah, there we go. So they start put down, but he's gonna have to buy a lot of time with drops, and he just lost, and he's gonna lose this one too. He's gonna lose like all of his drops here.
That's actually most of his medevacs. Only two remain, so future drops are kind of out of the question. Snoot may have just hit that perfect stride here in the late game. He's at 104 army supply to the 61 of Keen. The emphasis, though, goes on the type of supply. As you just pointed out, he wants to be making Vikings, he wants to be making Liberators, when he needs to be still producing medevacs.
Oh, jeez. That income graph is entirely in favor of Snoot here.
Oh, yeah. Keen, it's a wall of blue. Oh, my God.
Yeah, Keen got to four bases really quickly. He had a perfectly great mid-game. It just was never able to quite push through when he really needed to. Okay, not worth watching these drops. There they go. And Snoot was able to eventually get to all of these bases, mining pretty comfortably. It's not even really that many mining bases, like, man, Naturals mined out, but they've been fairly consistent after the initial drone damage. But there's the Broodlords, not so many of them that it's ultimate GG, like, game over, but enough certainly to add in that damage, and Marines have to get lucky enough to sim under them to actually take care of them, because there's not really any Vikings out. Three on the way now, there's about five. Five Vikings versus seven Corruptors and all those Queens on the ground. That's not good math for the Terran.
Never do math on stream, Summer Group.
I didn't. I just said it's not good math. So,
math is a hell of a drug.
This base, I believe, was the main. Yeah, it took quite a long time to get over there. Kills the drop while attacking that base too, which I think really sucks. I thought the drop had much chance of getting in. I like the Spore Crawler defense.
Yeah, I mean, it's silly, but I actually really do like the Spore Crawler defense quite a bit.
Yeah. Yeah, the base, or the map, has really just swung in favor entirely to Snoot. And I mean, that was kind of obvious once his economy started really ramping up and he got to Broodlords, but the creep spread has never died down. I know Keen's been scanning occasionally in the middle of the map, but with that many Queens, it's inevitable they're going to have energy to place down more Creep Tumors.
Well, of course, let's not forget Snoot and Ryung in the Ting Season 1 round of 8. Snoot showed us how much he knows how to control the sky. If it comes down to it, he'll get those Vipers, and he'll be able to take on any amount of air that comes out of Keen.
Yeah.
That was one of the most devastating engagements I think we've ever seen in Legacy of the Void so far, by the way.
Why'd you remind me of that? Oh, God. Yeah, Snoot absolutely has this game under control. I want to say there's an opportunity for Keen, but I actually can't think of one. You know, for Snoot, there's always a chance of a beautiful fungal, and if Vipers are out, Parasitic Bomb, or Crows of Biles. You know, there's all these splash options. When you look at Keen right now, without Liberators, there's really no splash options. There's no oh my god, if you could only get that one perfect hit.
So, even without the option of Liberators, I'm surprised this didn't go the direction of Ghosts. On one hand, you may have been anticipating Ultralisks, maybe not. Should have gone Ghosts. There's been so many Infestors, so many Queens. EMPs would have been worth a Ghost dying. Like, again, just surprised there hasn't been Ghosts. Oh, that fungal growth was nasty. That one mineral patch is the sickest bait of all time.
The rocks are being broken down over here, so this base could be under attack. It's a planetary, and it is the last mining base, so certainly Keen has to take care of it, but I guess he's going to try and take care of the goal. That's why his units were over there cleaning up creep. But with it, the rocks being broken down by Snoot, obviously it's not going to last very long. Final engagement, it looks like going down here, but Vikings over Spores over Queens. A really good concave of bio, but with no medevacs to heal him.
The Spores on the front line are probably the most alarming part of this, but with the fungal growth and the curse of Vows to get the Vikings, yeah, it's all just going to be a little too much, and Snoot will take game number one.
Hey, that was a really like the best case scenario arc for that bio, yeah. But what did it matter?
So I wanna try to appeal to people here now that we got a few more joining us on the stream. Instead of playing like a commercial break, we're just gonna talk for a second, okay? So hopefully you guys can listen. There's actually still like 80 something codes left for the Maturino page, guys. And BTP Apocalypse was asking in chat, like, what do I get for donating a dollar? Well, first off, you don't actually have to donate the dollar. It's free for you. Maturino is the one who puts the dollar in. That's their thank you for visiting their website. And you help grow the prize pool. As stated by Maturino, and you can see it on that prize pool page, guys, they're going to add $20 to the prize pool for every $100 we raise. So if you help us reach that $100 goal, we're at 80 right now. Oh, speak of the devil, Riomar just donated exactly Woo! Enough money to even it out to 100. So that's thank you so much, Riomar. Says the North remembers hashtag. $100 raised now is the prize pool, but there's still lots of free codes available. And the reason we're emphasizing the free code aspect of this is you don't have to put your PayPal information. You don't have to provide credit card information. All you do is log into their website with your Twitch account and boom, donate a dollar with the code BTTV6.
Yep. Super easy. Really doesn't require much at all. Thanks to,
Citizen A20.
Yeah, I guess. Yes, Citizen, Citizen A20.
C1D1ZENA20.
There you go. Thanks for the 2 month resub, and thanks for having a very easy name.
No.
It's a joke, you don't have an easy name. Damn you.
Who does capitals like that? Go back to Brood War.
Go back to 1999.
XXXSSJ Vegeta, uppercase, lowercase, SSXX.
Game number two here on Dusk Towers. It was this guy's pick in the bottom left. It's the Return Keen.
And in the upper right, he's blue. He's Zerg. He's up one. It's Team Liquid Snoot. And while Snoot and Keen may be perhaps the best named matchup for this round, I just want to point out Healer and Demi Love are currently playing underneath this. And that would have actually been, I think, a very close match and a very fun one to cast as well. Really sad we didn't get to see some more Healer action.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's possible we see him in the next one. He can have some odd matchups and odd builds, so Demi Love might be caught off guard.
There was some minor bracket drama to report on, too. And Zane, I guess, wasn't in the chat channel, and the 15-minute walkover thing happened, so that's why you see Major advancing over in Zane. Kind of sucks because Zane was here, but it was his fault for not doing things correctly, I suppose. I say this with a question mark because I don't actually know. This is just something we glimpsed at while we were between games earlier.
Yeah.
But Major waiting to play against Goblin or BioWay. Surprising that series going on for so long. Goblin is kind of a, I don't know, get it over with quick kind of guy to me.
Hey. I want to bring up something that someone in the chat said. I didn't remember the name, and I guess I'll call him out specifically, but the comment really, said that if Keen is down fee supply, it probably wasn't that good of a mid-game, because I said that Keen had a perfectly fine mid-game.
Oh, Keen was dropping all over the place. He wasn't doing bad at all.
Yeah, I was like, but that's not the thing, though. Like, there are good mid-games in that you win the mid-game, you win the entire game in the mid-game, and that's a pretty great mid-game, right? Like, that's every single Terran's ideal. But then there are also Terrans that don't have a good mid-game at all. Like, they don't get a fourth CC, they don't start dropping, they just, you know, are over here, like, bulking up their army, and then they go, and it's obvious they're going to lose, because they had really no mid-game. Keen had a perfectly fine setup mid-game. He had a quick fourth that was very seamless, he didn't, you know, he didn't have any lack of pressure forward, he was dropping, he was pushing in the middle of the map, and he just was unable to actually push forward with a main attack, and we see that all the time. Doesn't mean he has a bad mid-game. Could've been better, could've won the game off of it, but that doesn't make it bad. And I want to just emphasize that, because that's probably something we're going to see in this game too, is, since it is Dusk Towers, I can imagine that maybe he'll start off aggression with two base, as most Terran do, get to a third base, and then I think he's going to go for another relatively quick fourth, and then get his mid-game started from there. Because the other option is what we see, what we saw Euthermal do a lot. I think Euthermal's been mixing his own play up too, but Euthermal would only ever stay on three bases. Like, he'd drop in pressure, but he was only on three bases, and if it didn't work, he was like, it was basically all in, right? He just lost, because he didn't have an economy. He tried to, like, lift his main command center. And that's, it's an all-in, it can try and work, but I feel like Keen's style is the better one.
Super extra special shout-outs to H. Steimer, Twitch staff member. Ooh. 3 month resub. Excellent stream. Thank you. Well, thank you, sir.
Yeah,
for your support.
Thank you. I guess Overlord Speed is something that Snoot really likes.
Yeah, it's a pretty big staple of Snoot. Like, if you see him playing, scouting information is going to be, I think, one of the most important and most valuable things to him.
Yeah. So this is a little bit interesting. We actually have this pretty quick reactor on the starport, so while Snoot sees, like, he didn't actually go in and see that, right? He, like, went in, saw Marines are probably going to kill his Overlord, figured, I saw enough, I don't have to suicide the Overlord. Like, I have a good feeling I'm going to go for a Widowmine drop. It's actually not just a single Widowmine drop. It's going to be two drops. Like, they don't have to stand, they don't have combat shields, it's not the scariest double drop you've ever seen, but it is maybe one more medevac than you're used to, and Snoot does need to realize that.
So, by the way, that little speech between games certainly inspired people to start donating. If you recall, we hit exactly $100 before we got into this game. We're now at $163. So thank you guys all for donating. But also, special thanks out to Geep5 and Jambon Rose throwing in that $20. And $20, one, of course, coming from Maturino, as that was that $100 goal met. If we hit $200, we'll throw in another $20, I believe. We'll see how that works. Because I'm not sure if they'll count their $20 towards that, or... Because then we only have to raise 80 in between.
That's a good point. I wonder if they thought about that.
Well, either way, more money is always better. And, of course, we want to see these players get paid as much as possible. Of course, quick reminder that the top 4 slots in this tournament are what get paid.
Yeah. Okay, so the double medevac drops were defended the same as, like, a single medevac drop would have been. So not such a great opener for Keen quite yet. Still looking for an opportunity to drop, but... Again, even if he does get to drop, the scariest thing in these medevacs is actually the Widowmine, not even the, 14 Marines, because they don't have Stimmer Combat Shields. But this is where the Liberators can help out a little bit. They can help pick away at the Queens, they can get the Queens out of position, or they can die to a Sporecrawler.
Yeah, I mean, this one spot here isn't the sweet spot, but there is a sweet spot you can kind of hit in this map specifically. We talked about this with Nurtio and a lot of other players. We watched it recently with you, Thermal. Widowmine focus fired on top of the Queen. I actually love that choice. The Marines are taking care of the Lings, no problemo. The Queen's really low. They'll clean this up. Now Snoot's actually in quite a bit of trouble. He doesn't have any army to fight with. Queen over here takes out that Liberator, but unfortunately, what do you do about these Marines? You just have to run.
Yeah, that was really unideal. I mean, it's like, you know, you lose all your Lings, that sucks, but hopefully you take out more than half of this leftover army. To have still this many Marines left over is quite bad. Saves the medevac, which still has some energy. She could pick up. She could try and just, stay behind and heal. And they can certainly take on Queens, especially without the transfuses. I think one more's about to have another transfuse. This one's about to have a transfuse. The Queens could probably take care of this. Oh, but he misses the transfuse! He misses the second one! Uh-oh. Well, this is actually... For what was such a solid, easy defense, I mean, the Queens were over here, the Lings were over here, like nothing was to be done.
It should have been a solid, easy defense.
Yeah, I mean, he cleaned up the Liberator here with no problem. Like, Keen definitely was not derped on here, and here wasn't too great either. He, one mistake, one just letting double medevacs drop into the natural, and Snoot's took a lot of damage.
Okay, but let's assess this damage, right? Only 6 drones died, so in that regard, not bad. But that was quite a few Queens, 5 Queens went down, 46 Lings, that was not a cost-effective defense out of Snoot. But I do love that he protected his economy at, the utmost importance. So, recovering that, not so bad. 72 workers at 7 minutes in the game, 4 bases? I mean, okay, that totally sucked for Snoot. And he needs army, right frickin' now really bad, but he's not in the worst-case scenario.
That's a good point. I think the worst thing coming from this, besides the dip in army supply, which was pretty significant, was I believe this is a bit late of a lair. His 1-1 has been done for some time. It just feels a little bit late, and I think we'd have already wanted to start 2-2 and Roach Speed. He'd probably hold off on the Infestors. I'm not sure. He has enough gas. They could probably have slapped it on immediately. Oh, there, yeah. He slaps it on immediately. So, I mean, 20, 30 seconds doesn't seem like a lot, but if he messed up his macro at all, that is definitely something to consider with drops like that. Whereas Keen, I mean, he was the one dropping, but his macro really didn't slip. He has combat shields timing up pretty perfectly with 1-1, and this follow-up push obviously just pounces on the hatchery and gets it for free. So, it's pretty bad. I don't even think, Snoot has a couple of Ravagers, but... I mean, imagine where he was last game. He had 9 Queens with, 3 more on the way. He had, I think, triple the amount of Ravagers to defend against this. And he made the defense look really easy. Here he loses a 4th base, and... Well, he didn't sacrifice any army to defend it, so he only lost the 300 minerals. It's still significant to let that go so easily.
Yeah. Drops in the main are deflected. Nicely done.
Yeah.
But they still have a pretty big attack outside the front door. And that fifth base, or excuse me, I guess fourth base, because the other one got canceled, knocked down as well, has to be canceled here for Snoot. Yeah. Not so fortunate for him when it comes to the economic front. Let's not forget, when we looked at the income graph last game, it was a big wall of blue. It's still a little bit favoring Snoot, but it's nowhere near as bad as that first game was between the two of them. Mm-hmm. Like, that income difference was just disgusting to look at, frankly.
Yeah. Well, things are looking a little bit grim because Snoot can't get a fourth base. I would actually say it wouldn't be that bad. I'm a little surprised he's trying to. Okay. The thing is, once he has the Infestors out, I think he'll get a fourth base easily, provided that he sees the attack coming, because now his army's actually pretty damn good. But before the Infestors were out, his army wasn't big enough, and I can certainly see why he lost both those bases and now a third one, too. But I think now we can get it. Shouldn't have to cancel it again. If he has to cancel, that's pretty bad. You know, Keen's also starting his own fourth base. Keen didn't really, you know, I mentioned he didn't mess up his macro, but then he did, like, as soon as I said it. His upgrades aren't timed out very well. And they're still behind that of Snoot's, who might have missed a couple of seconds on his. So that kind of sucks for Keen, but the momentum of this game is, I think, better than the last. The numbers are equal right now, which is still, you know, Keen still has to bust through Infestor Corrosive Bile, and that's going to be very difficult to do. But he's in a better position, I would say. Well, let's see what he can do with his army. Plus one vehicle weapons is even getting researched. He did go for a second factory really quickly, so he has a couple more tanks than last game, too.
Well, those fungals looking to land on something. Of course, all they gotta do is hold anything in place for the Corrosive Bios to land, and they do take out all the tanks immediately. There's still a lot of Marauders, so it's a bit scary for the Roachers, but with so many Queens on that front line, if they're just soaking some of these hits, they're not armored units.
Medivac, please, why'd you go back into the Corrosive Bio?
I don't know, but dropping the main actually gets cleaned up pretty quick. Nice splits from Snoot. Once again, not segmenting his army too small, not segmenting it too low, but there's another attack coming in. And while he's able to focus on one part of this army, no problem. Splitting is always going to be the hardest part of this. But those Corrosive Bios land on top of some of the Marines. One of the Marauders gets caught here as well. A lot of the fuel over this fight of Snoot starting to run out. Like, there's not a lot of energy left on the Infestors. There's not a lot of Ravagers left, frankly. Snoot's going to have to make some more.
Might be able to save this Medivac.
By the way, Pastion Glance finishing up so late, I don't think Snoot was expecting to lose and have to remake so many Infestors.
That's a good point. These new ones will be fresh and full of energy, though. Lost a handful of drones as well, just all throughout the last minute and a half. So he's had to remake back up to, what is going to be at, 67, which is pretty damn good. His Greater Spire is already on the way. That may even be faster than last game. So that's definitely one thing Keen has to worry about. I feel like if he hadn't lost his tanks, especially with how quickly he lost them, Keen would be pushing, like so much harder. Oh, that was a good fungal. You know, he'd be up to, like, six tanks now instead of coming back from zero tanks. And that is a significant difference, especially if you get them in a good position and the Roaches and Ravagers all clump up and whatnot. Keen still has a good army, though, and he still has just a little bit of time. The Greatest Spire has to finish, Krubbers had to be made, and then Broodlords have to be made. So it's still a significant time for Snoot to buy. Scan does go down and sees the exact tech. I mean, this time I really like that he scanned, because I think last game was definitely expecting Ultras, so.
So I just want to point out, Snoot's always been a bit ahead of the curve. Like, Snoot's the one who made Swarmhost. Like, we knew Swarmhost versus Protoss was a big thing in HOTS. Snoot was the one who brought it versus Terran. Seeing Broodlords as the priority instead of Ultralis is really interesting to me, and I don't know that this is convincing me enough to say that this is going to be the new meta, but Snoot's, again, he tends to be the trend leader in these departments.
Yeah. Engagement doesn't go that badly. You got a couple of good fungals, a couple of good corrosive bios. I was going to say the tanks are lasting a lot longer than the initial attack, and that's where I think Keen started to trade out a little bit better, but it still ended up a pretty even trade, which is not really good enough for Keen quite yet. I guess at the same time that Snoot was going for his corruptors and upgrades too, Keen was adding on his starport, you know? He's not the Terran player that's gonna go all in, like, okay, if I don't beat them by the time Hive Tech's out, I'm gonna GG. He's shown he's willing to get the fourth base, obviously, which has been up for quite some time. He's willing to get those double, triple starports. I'm sure if we saw a long enough game with a good enough economy, he'd even go to Ghost Academy. But he's trying to prep for Broodlords. It's just a problem of, like, if it's gonna be, like, one of those games, you know, like Broodlord Infestor versus Viking, Ground Army, whatever you want to call it, for the Terran, usually Terran's a bit better SimCity and a bit more of a solid expansion plan, you know, than just like an orbital as your fifth. Because then Ling attacks are coming in and it's hard to take care of those. Although that usually is when they're upgraded. What's interesting about this late game is that for once the Lings aren't cracklings with 3-3 because they're going towards ultras this entire time, if Snoot makes Lings, they're actually going to be kind of lame. So maybe this expansion will be fine. I don't know.
Well, Keen was, up to this point, doing a really good job of keeping Snoot, I want to say, in check. Like, I hesitate to say that, right? Because it's not like he was stopping Snoot from doing things, but he did have Snoot at least, like, on the ropes, getting pressured, all this good stuff. Unfortunately, now, as we can see, that's not really the case, and Keen's in a... He's approaching that last game scenario where Snoot's getting away with so much in the late game.
Yeah. I think this time Keen didn't push one too many times or lose one too many Doom drops. So he's better set up to actually get to one of those split map scenarios.
But the problem of what killed him last game, like, I love the idea of going for Vikings. It's a smart necessity for Broodlords. However, it wasn't Corruptors that got him killed. It was the Curse of Biles. It was the Fungal Growth. The Vikings weren't even stacked. They had a wonderful, like, 360 concave.
I don't know about this move out. This doesn't... I don't know.
I do like the Ghost Academy, actually. This is a huge deal. It's a huge deal.
I like the Ghost Academy. I would have liked if he had waited for maybe, like, two more command centers on the way, you know? Like... I don't know. It's actually not going so badly because the tanks, the number was really high. I think one just died, but 7 tanks is nothing to scoff at for Roach Ravager. And the Infestors would be careful too. If they're clumped up, they'll go down pretty quick as well. So as you saw, Snoot really couldn't push into that army. But if Keen ever finds himself either fungled or like in like a little, you know, wide open area, then suddenly tanks don't look quite as good. So it's actually really scary, but I think Keen, he didn't really want to push into the army so much as he wanted to clear up the middle of the map to start dividing the map in, you know, 50-50 to get the planetaries in the front line.
But I love this misspelling of Maturino by Dom in chat. Macaroni. Cheesy macaroni. Dude, I could go for some macaroni so badly. Oh, I miss macaroni. Good. Yo, I used to have Katie like every day, man. Growing up, like when I was like 12.
KD. Oh, Kraft Dinner. That's what you guys call it. That's right.
Yeah, yeah. My mom would like make some like hot dog wieners to it too. It was so good.
Of course. I think you call it Kraft Dinner. Like, why did they change that? It's just Kraft macaroni and cheese for us. Oh, those fungals were pretty decent, but you know, that's a very tough army to chew through.
The Curse of Biles did not follow up the way that I think Snoot had intended to them. And this is a big problem because now he doesn't really have everything to stop the air. No, Fungal Growth's helping a little bit. We got the Corruptors on that front line. Broodlords will eventually break this. It looks like this will still go very, very barely in the favor of Snoot.
Yeah, he's still up 30 army supply, but he's only just used his bank. Keen's still kind of waiting, slash can't use his bank quite as quickly. He doesn't have all that larva bulked up, you know?
Oh, transfuse that Corruptor.
He is about to lose all of his air, though, and I don't know if Keen realizes that. Like, his medevacs are super low. His Vikings all went down except just this one.
This
it's really just the tanks.
Right, it's the tanks like that have just been free-firing. There should have been Curse of Biles on top of this, maybe instead of the Vikings. I don't know, but this ended up going not badly at all for Keen.
Yeah.
It, of course, still goes better for Snoot, no questioning that. But, man, Keen just invested in so much that it's way more difficult for Keen to replace this army than it is for Snoot. And I think that's what this game really boils down to.
Yeah, Keen's actually winning the income war now that he has an extra base, which would turn into a planetary. And this one's on the way as well. I mean, really, Snoot is missing one of the key elements of late-game Zerg, which is not Ultras. This isn't a QQ about Ultras. It's actually more about those Lings, you know? It's like, okay, you get to this, like, split-map scenario, you think you're doing well, and suddenly Knight is from the main base with Lings, and Lings are on a planetary, and since they're 3-3 cracklings, they actually kill everything before you can respond. That's where things have really been getting hairy recently in this matchup, you know? The Ghosts come forward, they think they're gonna get snipes on Ultras, bam, cracklings come and kill them. You know, they actually provide a lot of complication to fights. Without those little things running around, Keen is getting pretty easy expansions. And if he does ever get Ghosts, which remember, he got the Ghost Academy. I don't know why he's not getting any. He just figures he doesn't need them. He won't have to worry about that. He doesn't have to worry about Fungals, of course. But his expansions, at the very least, are safe. I mean, so are Snoots, right? Like, there hasn't been many drops lately or nukes coming down or anything like that. But... Keen is looking actually pretty good. And I really like that the tank thing is working. More so than just, you know, versus Ultras and their DPS, which I, you know, I always like really wish they would be the answer to Ultras. They're working in just containing or covering space. And
yeah.
It's actually pretty cool.
It's kind of going back to like what I think they were originally used for back in like HOTS and even question mark Wings of Liberty, where like they're zoning out the infestors the most. And of course it's the corrosive bowels that bring the damage, but it's the fungal growth. They're the bully that holds you in place while the corrosive bowels beat you up by the locker, right? So I mean, without that, you can't easily land those hits. Broodlord's getting sniped now. There's a lot of queens, a lot of transfuses keeping these bad boys alive, but as we note, nothing killing the Vikings.
Yeah, where are the corruptors? A couple now coming out, but I think that Snoot just didn't realize that all those corruptors died. And then he probably morphed the rest of them into Broodlords.
He's having some gas problems right now, and he didn't actually take both of his gases down to the south, which is a small oversight, but going to turn out to be a pretty big mistake.
Oh, fungals are still available. Keen might have thought they weren't available anymore.
The Vikings! Gross, the files land, and this
is like... that one mistake, man.
Justice reigns from above.
I wish I had caught Keen's vision, because I don't think he saw the infestors to the top, and it's like one of those things where you think they don't have any more High Templars, you rush in, suddenly storms left and right, you know? I don't think he was expecting to get fungled like that, and he has to retreat, and now that went from, you know, kind of trading okay, maybe 20 supply down, to now 60 supply down.
We really need, like, an Overwatch soundboard where we can just, seriously, when stuff like that happens, play Pharah's ultimate sound, stuff like that. Like, that was ridiculous.
It'd actually be kind of fun. Well, I think that Keen is now in a very terrible position. Like, that went very quickly from, like, okay, he's not doing bad. He actually has a better economy. His army's looking okay. He could probably add a couple things to it. And he'd be pretty golden to, okay, now he's lost all of his bank. His base had to be lifted for a second there. And he just plummeted in supply. Snoot's not pushing in eagerly to end the game. So I guess Keen's going to be able to get maxed out again. But that was certainly not a very good trade, and not very, like, you know, optimistic for the future if it's going to continue to have trades like that. This drop was definitely necessary.
Super duper shout-outs go to Remark. Just donated another $20 to the Match Arena page. So we're now sitting at a $188 prize pool. I don't know if there's any coupon codes left. I hope we've used them all up. I don't think we have. But make sure to go to the site, guys. BTTV6 is the code. This orbital getting pushed off is kind of a big deal. He's got
so
that
scary
creep there as well, so placing this back down is not going to be easy.
I was trying to check to see how many bases he has.
I think Keen's actually SOL. Look at this. He doesn't have any gas left. He really needed this base. He doesn't actually have the geysers to take at the one base he has.
I was gonna say.
And he needs more Viking production. Forget the minerals for a moment. He just has no gas to work with.
I really wish he had gone for... actually, more ghosts than more Vikings, to be honest. Not that Vikings are bad.
I agree.
You know,
actually, did we see any ghosts? He hit the Ghost Academy. I don't think we saw any ghosts.
But when you consider how well his tanks have been zoning everything out, imagine the Brood or the Ghost coming in and getting a lot of snipes down as Snoot tries to retreat or anything like that.
Okay, yes, sure. But at the same time, like, just EMP those infestors. EMP the queens to stop the transfuses.
Yeah,
I mean,
actually,
so many situations where I think that would have been precedent over anything else.
I just assume that the infestors aren't going to get EMP'd. Like, the Zerg's control is too good. But the queens were certainly always on the front line. Like, that would have been easy EMPs. So definitely in that department. The Vikings are going a little ham. The Infungals are all gone, I suppose, but they also are starting to run over Spore Crawlers. The
Keen,
Queens come back,
man.
And yeah, it looks like Keen is going to just be dead.
You know what I think is a big problem with this game?
What's that?
There's no good Zergs in Korea right now for Keen to practice against. So it comes up against Snoot and is like, oh, what? You know how to play this game?
It's like becoming a meme, I swear to God. Like, I don't know if it's like partially
it's going to
our
be on
fault,
our channel, that's
or...
for certain.
Yeah, right? Or if this is just something that, like, every other caster or gamer is talking about. But it's, like, it's a legitimate question. I'm not going to say, like, definitely Zergs are bad in Korea. But after 6.5 years, we finally have a scenario where the foreigner race is better. Because it was always the Korean Terrans were better than everyone else, right? They always had that mantle. Is it now foreigner Zergs are better than everyone else?
Because I know there's going to be the one elitist out there who wants to call us out on this. This isn't even the first example. It was like months ago where Nurchio ended Byun's insane win streak with the first instance of fungal growth and corrosive bile combos. So congratulations to Snoot. Advances on in the brackets. He'll fight either Healer or Demi Love. Cham advances in the bottom side, knocking out Tang Tangs. Once again, foreign Zerg taking it over the Koreans. We're going to go to a small commercial break here on our end while we figure out what match we get into next. We may be waiting a little bit of time, though, because some of these games still haven't finished up. But they should be finishing up soon. Quick reminders to go to that Match Arena page one last time, guys. I want to make sure every single coupon code gets used. So we're at $191 at the time of me reading this. I want to see that say like an easy $200 when we get back from break. So make sure to go to the website, use the code BTTV6, and we'll see you guys in 2 minutes.